Welcome. Hi and welcome. So, we're going to have a look at 6M1, The Armies Face Off. Now, what's interesting is that a lot of 6M1, the original, is actually unused in the film at this particular point. So, according to the Ultimate Edition soundtrack, this is the track where Darth Sidious receives and uses the Gungan's army. I've put a little playlist here, but if you just search for it, it's track 48, and then it becomes track 49, the Gungan's March. Now, these both are from 6M1 that Williams originally wrote. There's a cut to the timpani, which then sort of comes in halfway through what I've called bar 15, and then it continues to the end of that cue. In the original, it then goes straight into the droid march. That sort of one, which we've heard before, but it just doesn't happen in the film, and it sort of quickly segues into this little flourish, which I can't find any sheet music for at all, so I've sort of orally dictated it as best I can. If I spend a bit more time on it, I might be able to get a few more correct things, but I think I've broadly got the harmony here. Which is sort of F minor, C, in other words, second inversion F minor, second inversion C minor, then our usual sort of sci-fi chord, and then ends on a C. There's a long pause, and then we go into the track where the Queen and her group sneak back into the palace. There's a small edit where they've kind of, I mean, it's almost that it's, I didn't want to change the bar numbers, so this is repeated, the double bass pizzicato is repeated, and one of these flute interjections is also repeated. And then we get into combinations of two different transpositions of octatonic scales, which I'll go back into. After that, there's a bunch of action music cues, which I think everybody's been waiting for, so I will spend a lot of time on that. What I'll probably do, though, because the film was so heavily edited from what Williams wrote, is I'm going to have to probably do the scores for 6M1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 in order to then find that music somewhere in written form, because there's quite a lot that might not have been actually written down, and it says it was dictated from the podium, which sounds like a very laborious process, one that nobody would want to wish upon their worst enemy, quite frankly, although I suppose that's what the orchestrators get paid for. But, you know, it's very, very hard work indeed. to orally dictate stuff, especially for an entire film. Crazy, really, but there we go. Done it myself with Henry V, Walton. That was pretty time consuming, I can tell you. Anyway, back to the case in hand. So I've got the sort of the real Sibelius bit here. I've also made the movie anyway, but it's definitely worth discussing. The first page really is based almost entirely on Hungarian minor scales. So that we've got Hungarian minor on A, then we've got a sort of Hungarian minor, I think I put in D, although it's not actually that clear, but I think it is there actually, Hungarian minor and D, and then another Hungarian minor in D as well. It doesn't seem that way when you just look at it on the surface, but when you really go into it, it is. So let's get stuck in and sort of maybe explain a few things here. So the first thing is the first chord, really. So there are some things that we can spot. So here we've got A minor. Let's ignore that for the time being. So we've got our A minor chord, but there's the sharp four with it as well. So that's 4-18-B in actual fact. I haven't actually put it there because it combines into something else in a minute. But what's interesting is in the strings we've got A minor. Okay, let's forget about the bass note for the time being. In the brass, we've only got A flat major. So that's really interesting. So a semitone away, although they share the middle note C, which is interesting. Then we've also got A minor in the clarinet, which is sort of, I guess, interjecting what the strings were doing. But then we've got C augmented. Obviously, all of these share notes in the flutes. Now we put them all together with the A flat changed to a G sharp, and we get that set 5-22-01-4-7-8, which is a combination of sets 4-19, which is a minor scale with a major seventh, a minor triad with a major seventh, and 4-18-B, which is a minor chord with a sharp four. Sometimes I call it a flat five, just because of the way it's written down notationally. Often. Is not as a sharp but as a flat, but that could just be for ease of players reading rather than any sort of theoretical reason for that. So if we extrapolate those notes, so we've got A, C, D sharp, E and G sharp, we can see that they're very clearly related to the Hungarian minor on A. The problem is, of course, that A is not in the bass. So whatever you use for this scale, you don't always have to start off with a bass note of something. We can combine lots of different polychords with them. And this is what Williams has done. Really interesting. So we got our sort of wrong note bass. Then we've got our A flat. And then we've got our augmented as well. Really, really extraordinary. But that pretty much lasts for the whole of the bar. We've got other slight interjections here. So, for example, the A sharp I put is not part of the Hungarian minor, but Williams loves putting in those odd notes for added gnarl, which he does. So, you know, there's nothing unusual about that. We've got our bass drum, which is emphasising the pizzicato on the main beats at that point. And then a sort of hybrid emperor. All in sort of various inversions, sometimes in first inversions, sometimes in second inversions, sometimes in root position. Broadly speaking, second inversions for the final bit and first inversions, broadly speaking, for the first little bit. But it's a really interesting sort of way of writing. Everything is sort of very close together and in some ways tertiary related. I'm not playing the inversions until then. Like that. Really interesting sort of combination of minor chords, all minor chords, which sort of don't necessarily relate to each other. But they're all planing. sort of planing. You know, there are times where he's really sort of trying to get that sort of chromatic approach in the top part. The only gap being the last one, disjunct movement there. This was interesting. You know, when I first saw it, I thought, what on earth is that? So we got D minor and then like that. But actually, it's 6Z19B. Really interesting. So D minor. And then we got B flat minor with a sharp 4. There we go. And if you combine them, they make 6Z19B. We see it so often. But you wouldn't know it relates to the Hungarian minor because you might be sort of thinking of that Hungarian minor and those notes aren't all in it. There's no D there, for example, or B flat. So you sort of think, oh, where's that from? So by the pitch class set theory, we can find a link. And in fact, this is just a different Hungarian minor. I guess it sort of makes sense because D minor is at the beginning here. So everything harmonizes that, you know, perfectly well. So the only difference between Hungarian minor is the fourth, which is raised. Yeah, it's a sort of really interesting sort of, I guess, modulation from a Hungarian minor, but it doesn't sound like it because of the E flat. Then we're into C minor. And then up a tone into D minor. Whoops, edit mode, stop. Yeah, it's a sort of kind of confusing, really, because, you know, how does he get from C minor from this chord here, where you've got this sort of... you know, really, there's only, I guess, one pitch, which is a sort of pivot note, which is the C, but it's not obvious. But I suppose it's significant because of the fact that it is a pivot note. You know, you don't always need a pivot chord. You can have a pivot note as well. That's worth bearing in mind. But that's pretty, you know, now understandable. But when I first saw it, it was just sort of a complete mess of notes. I didn't know where to begin. But it's interesting that so often the harmonic DNA is Hungarian minor, this 6Z19B, a type of hexatonic, but not the usual one that's 620, which is the minor second, minor third, minor second, minor third. So it's slightly different, and he doesn't always use, you know, the middle note. And I think that is important, this sort of other form of hexatonic that you can get. So then we move into a really interesting bit where we've got another 521. We've got a different five note set, but that is drawn from the hexatonic 6Z19B, and then we've got a little 3-3 cheeky 0-3-4 at that point. So 3-3 is the linking set that links Hungarian minor, octatonic, harmonic minor, all those sorts of things. And he can often put them in different configurations. You know, often it's that sort of 0811 type of atonal type thing. But it's interesting here how it's sort of, you know, basically put on something else. So you've got F minor with some added notes, which make up the 521. And then uses something else from a different set entirely. Those 3-3 notes have nothing to do with 521 at all. 521 being a subset of 6Z19B. Then we go into the Hungarian minor, so 521 being a subset of 6Z19B, which is also another subset of Hungarian minor. That makes sense. Okay, they have links there. But this is an interesting one. A Hungarian minor in D, but without the D, which is extraordinary. So if I do the Hungarian minor, took me ages to work this out. But then take away the D, we get this really interesting little set here, which is called 6Z44, which is the Z mate to 6Z19B. So it still shares the same interval vector, or the same interval class. In other words, the same quantity of minor seconds, major seconds, minor thirds, major thirds, perfect fourths, augmented fourths. But it just has a different configuration of them, which is really fascinating. And thereby, he is drawing out Hungarian minor chords, but without the root note of the Hungarian minor. It took me ages to work out where it all came from, but I think I've managed to get this sort of just about okay. There will always be the odd note which doesn't fit in. So, for example, here, you know, D sharp is nowhere near there. But, like, the majority of notes really are. So all of this, pretty much, apart from the C natural, is drawn from the Hungarian minor. And it sounds like it when you play it. That's just another inversion. Like this. And because of the semitones in the middle, we've got this sort of really unusual sort of chromaticism, which is exploited pretty much all the time by Williams. And then we've got this sort of lovely sizzling cymbal which goes into the march at that point. But it's definitely worth sort of, you know, revisiting and working out how to get from different Hungarian minors and then obscuring the melody, you know, obscuring the harmony as much as you can whilst retaining little block chordal harmonizations all the way through. So that's interesting, is that actually there is a triad of some description all the way through this. In this case, it starts off with the brass, starts off with the horn section of the brass and then the trombone section of the brass. All the way through, there's some form of block chordal harmonization with a simple chord, in other words, not a seventh. It's just a triad of some description. No diminished triads, all minor ones, or augmented triads. Augmented ones being, generally speaking, a bit of a giveaway that it's some sort of hexatonic thing going on, often. So I think that's sort of just about covered it, but, you know, in terms of exercises, what you could do, I think really I would start off with just brass and the bass note and then try and draw different Hungarian minors from important points in the brass. So, for example, ending up on this D flat. D flat augmented. You know, there's a Hungarian minor which has those notes in them. So maybe drawing from that around the target note. Here, F minor, well, yes, we got F minor, then we've got a little 3-3 thing going on. But I think that's probably the way I'd approach it. So in other words, important target notes I would then harmonize with the corresponding Hungarian minor, or, you know, missing out maybe the fourth note, so we get our 6Z19B, around those target notes. And usually, in terms of film, it would be something which is going on screen, which is sort of interesting. So, we've then got into the Gungan's March, which is another track. Not really much needs to be said. The timpani comes in halfway through, although it's written down. It doesn't really get an entry until there, set 532. I don't really think that's particularly significant, but there we go. It is another set that he uses quite frequently. And then all of this sort of orally dictated stuff, which I think I've just done, really. Like that. I think I've got broadly the harmony all the way through there. It's extremely difficult to sort of just do, really. Probably easier to just fully orchestrate all the way through and then do a reduction, but I didn't bother with that. So then we go into the Queen and her group sneak back into the palace. And this is a really, really, really unusual one, where we've got lots of different octatonic sets. So I've output combination of two octatonic transpositions. Do we call this poly-octatonic chromaticism? I don't know. It sounds really sort of poncy, doesn't it? But I think there's no other way of doing it. So in terms of explanation, octatonic T0, in other words, it's transposed by no semitones, starts on C, and I'm doing the semitone tone version of this. Octatonic T1 is a semitone above that. And then octatonic T2 starts on D, like that. So we've got little clear octatonic sort of little sets here. So this one, 0134, starts it off. That's set 4-3, and that's from octatonic T2. It's just the last sort of few notes. Then we've got dyads from T1 octatonic, and then we've got some other dyads from T0 octatonic. So we've got three different octatonic scales here. We've then got little 3-3s. Remember, 3-3 is the linking set between different sorts of other sets. It could be hexatonic, could be octatonic, could be Hungarian minor. Doesn't matter. They all work. In this case, it's not necessarily a usual thing. I think that is a usual thing. So, you know, when you've got a major seventh, and then you've got your augmented fifth above the root. Like that. So we've got those. Then we've got little chromatic harp going on there. And then we've got this little, sort of thing. So a little sort of triplet figures. Diddle-da-dup, diddle-da-dup, diggity-dup, diggity-dup. So we've got that link. I'm just highlighting them there, and right at the beginning, sort of. Obviously, that's in diminution to that. And I guess, you know, the figuration is very similar to, you know, it sort of grows from that. So little seeds. Then we've got a really interesting thing here. So we've got a little harp thing drawn from octatonic T1. Which is then repeated all the way through the harp. And then it does something different. So it actually becomes T2 in the end, having started at T1. We've then got this F minor with a sharp 4. 418B, some people call it flat 5. Which is drawn from T2, but also a Hungarian minor in F as well. But let's forget about Hungarian minor for the time being. We've got T2 octatonic, so the one that starts on D. We've then got this, which combines with that. But then our bass line is drawn from T1 octatonic, the reason being that I've included the C-sharp and everything else as well from that in order to come to that conclusion. Then we've also got here, which is part of what the harp was already doing, octatonic T1, but notice it's harmonised in major thirds, not minor thirds. Like that, which is really interesting. I haven't seen that frequently, because normally you would harmonize octatonics with minor thirds. Like that. But he chose to harmonize it with major thirds. Fair enough. But there's definite combinations of octatonics going on at the same time. And then that just repeats all the way through. That then swaps to an octatonic T1 with one errant note. Yeah, there's no, but everything else is drawn from octatonic T1. So I mean, I'm saying it's octatonic because it sounds octatonic, and also that the majority of notes are from that specific octatonic transposition. In this case, octatonic T1 and octatonic T2 as well. So that's why I've come to that conclusion. They're in different instrument groups as well. So maybe that's also significant too. octatonic T1. All the strings are in octatonic T1 except the violins, which are from T2, but notice the polarity of it. Very, very high and very, very low as well. So that's, again, quite significant, I think. And then it just sort of carries on like that. I haven't really bothered adding any more because it's just the same thing. And then we've got that little hints of the Emperor's theme right at the very, very end of the cue. And then suddenly it goes into what's called The Battle Begins, but actually is 6M2, but only the first few bars of it. It then stops, goes into 6M3 suddenly, but only halfway through, then goes back to the beginning of 6M3. It's really, really confusing. So I think what I'm going to be doing is having to notate all of the different things. So I'll probably do little work in progress videos rather than the full reduction. And then I will do the full reduction, of course, but it's just going to take a bit of time to do because it is complicated, basically. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed that. I think it's really interesting. Sort of two different sort of bits of cue. They are from the same written cue, 6M1, so all of this is the same, apart from this little interjection, which I can't find any sheet music for at all, but there we go. So orally dictated, but Hungarian minor, little exercise in that using 3-3 and pivot notes as a sort of pivot in between different types. Then we've got a bit of nonsense going with the percussion. Then we've got two different combinations of octatonic things going on, which is nice, a sort of sneaky little sort of thing, where sometimes you're harmonizing in minor thirds, sometimes you're harmonizing in major thirds. And yeah, it's just a little, a nice, interesting exercise before it gets into the madness of the action music, which is forthcoming, which I'm really excited to show you because there's so much in there. It's really interesting. Right, that's it for this week, and I'll see you again soon.